Today, I'll try to explain a little bit what we know and mostly what we don't know about deep neural networks. But I'll try to put that in a bigger framework of learning. What are the main questions that we are asking ourselves when we are trying to attack these very high-dimensional learning problems? So let me begin with the problem and the notations. The learning problems we are facing is in high dimension, which means that the data that I'll be writing X across all the tutorial is a very high dimensional vector. So think for X as being, for example, an image. What we'll be learning is a function f of X given a set of examples. So we have a family of example xi, and in the context of an image processing problem, what we know is the label of each of the images yi. So for example, here you have anchors, Joshua trees, beavers, and so on. And these images have about 1 million pixels, so we are typically here in a dimension 1 million. Now, when we look at such a problem, we immediately realize the big difficulty is that within each of the class, there is a considerable variability that needs to be captured and typically reduced while keeping enough information in order to be able to distinguish these different classes. So what you'll see through the talks is the theme of invariance. How can you reduce variabilities within each of the class but still maintain enough information in order to discriminate these different classes? I will be taking examples also from physics. So what does it mean to learn physics? In the case of physics, X will typically describe the state of the system. So think, for example, in astronomy, X would correspond to the distribution of mass, let's say, within a galaxy. And if you want to learn physics, for example, you may want to learn the energy functional. Because if you can associate to a certain state its energy, then you have access to interaction forces by computing derivatives. And this functional is a priori a very complex function that depends upon these unknown interactions if you don't know the physics. So what do you have to learn? The physics, you have examples. In this case, that means that you have example of configurations. So if you go to the infinitely small, then you'll have, for example, the problems in quantum chemistry. The different X corresponds to different molecules and designates the different positions of the atoms and their charges. And what you would like from the different examples of molecules, sorry, what you have is different examples of molecules and the known energies of these different molecules. Given that, you are given a new molecule and you want to compute its energy without knowing anything about Schrödinger equations or quantum physics. Is that possible to do it? Now, if you look at the problem from the physics point of view, what we know very well is that the interactions are characterized by the symmetries of the system. If you know the symmetries, you have access to the Lagrangian from which you can get the energy. So, symmetries, invariants, that's again something that we'll constantly find across the talk. So, why is that problem so difficult? The problem is so difficult because of the curse of dimensionality that I suppose all of you know. But let me rephrase it. A priori, the problem looks relatively simple. You have examples, xi, you know the value f of xi, so what you just have to do is to interpolate the function. You are now given a new point x, you know the value of your function in hopefully close points, and you want to compute the value of f at x. How are you going to do? You just can interpolate from the closest nearest values. Now, why does it never work in high dimension? It never works in high dimension because you never have close neighbors. You never have close neighbors. If you look at images, you can immediately realize it. If this is an image, if you take another image of the same class, let's say a beaver, there is no reason why, if you compute the Euclidean distance of these two images, namely, you compute the subtraction and you sum the square of the results, that this is going to be small. In fact, the distance between these two images has no reasons to be any closer than in between these two or these two. In other words, all the points are spread around in the space. And the reason is due to high dimensionality. Why? Take a cube. So let's think of 0, 1 in dimension D. If you want to guarantee that you have a point close to yourself at a distance smaller than epsilon, then you need to sample your cube at distances smaller than epsilon. How many points do you need? You need epsilon to the power minus d. Now take for epsilon 1 over 10, which is not very small. Take for d 100, you already get 10 to the power 100, which is more than the number of atoms in the universe. Now d is not going to be 100, but rather a million. So there is no way you can sample your cube, and in fact the points are very sparsely spread in the space. Now, the consequence of that is that a priori you have no chance to be able to learn. So how come we can learn relatively complex functions? And what are the classes of functions that we can learn? This is the main mystery of learning. Now, one of the points of the talk will be to show that there is a very important regularization aspect in these problems, is the fact that in large classes of problem, you can separate scales. And that will reduce this exploding complexity to something which is manageable. Think a set of D particles which are interacting in a space, okay? Now, these D particles, you may think of them as pixels in an image. So they are indexed by their spatial position, or they may correspond to agents in social networks, or they may correspond to words in a text, and so on. Now, if you look, you take each particle, a priori, they are going to interact with any other particle, even relatively far away, if the potential decreases slowly, which is very often the case in physics, for example, in electrostatics. However, there is something very important, is that the interactions, you have d particles, so d square interactions, can be reduced to much less interactions. How? By observing that the very strong interactions will be based, the close particles, pixels which are close to one another are very correlated, or let's say you are very much in interaction with your own family. Now, you cannot neglect interactions with more far away particles, but this interaction can be summarized by looking at the equivalent potential that these particles are creating on yourself. And if you take even more far away particles, for example, if you think of Russians somewhere in Siberia, you may think that they have negligible influence on your life. Yes, but if you take Russia as a whole, if there are, for example, tension between Russia and India, that can influence your life. So you cannot neglect the overall interaction, but you can try to summarize it. And if you do that, and you group with bigger and bigger group, the number of interaction terms will go from d squared to log d squared. And this is the basis of, for example, multiple techniques to do fast computations in physics. So that structuration of the problem is killing the curse of dimensionality. So multiscale will be very much at the center of all what I'll be speaking about today, and in particular of deep networks. Now, multiscale will be related to wavelets, and I'll summarize the main idea of wavelets and how it relates both to these hierarchical multiscale architecture, but in particular to deep networks. So the overview of the tutorial is the following. First, I'm going to begin with one hidden layer network and how does it relate to approximation theory in mathematics. And what I'll try to show is that right now there is a basic failure of mathematics to understand what's happening in high dimension. And I'll explain in what sense the tools we have don't work to attack the high dimensional problems. So then we'll move to dimension reduction. I'll briefly go over kernel learning and look at the techniques to try to reduce the dimensionality of a problem through changes of variable, and that will lead us to deep networks. Now, there is one important idea that can help understand structures of deep networks behind these ideas of multiscale, is the notions of symmetry groups and invariants. And there we are going to come back to the ideas that I was illustrating at the beginning. Symmetry is obviously a very important concept in mathematics and physics, but we'll see how it very naturally appears whenever you have to deal with learning problems. And I will first look at the simplified architecture of these deep networks with wavelets and the so-called wavelet scattering transform. It's a way to begin by simplifying the problem to see what kind of mathematics we can understand and how far we can go numerically through these simplifications. I'll show applications to physics, images, and audio classification, but I will also show in what sense these simplifications are not sufficient and what are the open problems behind all that. And there is an archive review paper that I wrote that summarizes a lot of the ideas of the tutorial. Okay, so let me come back to the core problem. So in all these problems again, X will be the vector, the data vector, and we are trying to approximate a function f of x given a set of example xi and the value of the function at each of the xi. And in approximation theory, the idea is you want to build an approximation of your function with a limited number of parameters, and the number of parameters has to be smaller typically than the number of examples, or let's say equal to the number of examples. And the question is, what kind of regularity can you impose on f so that you will be able to indeed get a good approximation from only m parameters? Now, if you deal with classification problem, let's say binary classification, so you have two classes, 1 and minus 1, I'll be considering that the function f of x, you can define it as a sine of a more regular function f tilde, and the underlying regular functions, so f is the boundary of classification corresponds to the level set, the zero level set of f tilde, and f tilde will be the underlying function that you that is really potentially regular that you want to approximate. So, question, what kind of regularity and how can we compute this approximation? So this is a very classical question in approximation theory, and here comes these neural networks. So I'm going to look at it first on one hidden layer neural networks, which are very well understood. So, what is a neural network? You have an input x, and what you do is a linear combination of each of the entries of your vector x with weights w, k, n, so it's like an inner product between x and a vector w that gives you the output. Now, this output, you are going to transform it with a nonlinear function rho, which is a very simple function. It can be an absolute value, an arctangent, but it's a function of one variable. And then you take all these outputs and you do a new linear combination and you have your approximation fm, which is therefore a linear combination through these alpha n of your function rho applied to the inner product of x projected on wn plus the bias. Okay. Yes? So n here, the small n goes from 1 to m. M is the number of hidden variable. It's the number of vector wn. Okay, so n goes from 1 to m. So you have a linear combination with m inner neurons within your network. Now, if
you don't know...
Here you are going to fix m, and it's whatever it is, and the whole problem is how well will I be to approximate my function if m is sufficiently big, and how big should be the number of neurons in order to approximate well the function, okay? And rho here is a one-dimensional function. So if you look at this function, these functions are called ridge functions because this function is constant if you move orthogonally to the vector Wn and will have a one-dimensional variation. This is the case of a sigmoid if x varies along Wn. So you basically approximate f as a linear combination of ridge functions. So these are the parameters which are learned, okay? And you try to learn them so that the function fn that you get here is going to get you the best possible approximation of the original function f. And the question is, how well can I approximate f if I choose optimal parameters here? And what this theorem tells you is that if rho is a reasonably bounded function, then when m goes to infinity, you can approximate any function f from such a neural network when with an error that goes to zero. No, infinity is m, the number of neurons goes to infinity, okay? For any fixed d, d is fixed, this is the dimension of the problem, m is the number of neurons goes to infinity. Okay. No, yeah, but I mean, your function f belongs to L2 of 0, 1 to the power of d. This is an infinite dimensional space. This is an L2 space, it's an infinite dimensional space. Now, what I want to emphasize is that this theorem is almost empty. It's almost empty in what sense? You are not interested to have an error when m goes to infinity. You are interested in having an error which decays very fast when m goes. And you don't want the number of neurons which increase exponentially in the dimension d. And just to show you, I mean, it's not empty in the sense it's nice to prove it, but it doesn't break the curse of dimensionality. And just to show you a simple example, take for rho the exponential e to the iux. What you are just getting by doing that is a Fourier series. And obviously, it's well known that you can decompose any function in Fourier series. The problem is the number of Fourier coefficient is going to be huge, okay? So that kind of theorem, which says one-layer neural network solves it all, is true but wrong. Wrong in the sense that the number of neurons is impossible to reach, okay? But that's the question. So then the question is, maybe my function class is too big. Maybe if I put some regularity, I'll be able to reduce it. Thanks very much. That will be the next step. So let's try to put some regularity on f. So suppose f is a regular function, okay? And let's take for rho a rectifier. So if you take a rectifier, rho of u is 0 for u negative and linear for u positive. So what are you doing? You are building an approximation of your function as a linear combination. Now, x is one-dimensional, to make it simple to begin with. So d equals 1. Linear combination of rho of x minus n, and I'm going to use for the different points a uniform sampling of x. So what am I really doing? I'm doing a piecewise linear approximation of my function. So how good will this be? So suppose that the function is Lipschitz. So let's say has bounded derivatives. So the number of n is related to epsilon. We'll see that. We'll see in one line. So we suppose that the function is regular, okay? So f of x minus f of x prime is of the order of x minus x prime. So suppose that you sample all the x as a distance smaller than epsilon. So then you are guaranteed that the difference between f and f tilde, if you make piecewise linear approximation, will be smaller than epsilon. How many points do you need? You need to cover your interval at a distance epsilon. Again, you need 1 over epsilon points. So that means that the error, if you name insert here, epsilon is equal to 1 over n, is going to decay like 1 over n. So good. The error decays relatively fast. Let's do the same thing in dimension D. So, same thing in dimension D. Now, X is a vector in dimension D. I still suppose that my function is regular, so Lipschitz. How many points do I need if I want to sample at a distance epsilon so that the error is smaller than epsilon? The number of points now is the number of points to cover my cube at a distance epsilon. It's going to be epsilon to the minus d. If you insert m equals epsilon to minus d here, you get an error which decays like m to the power of one, minus 1 over d. Think for d, again, being 1 million, that means your error doesn't decay at all. That means that the number of m is going to be absolutely huge. So, okay, maybe that's because we are not regular enough. So let's put more regularity. What would you do if you are doing math and you want to put more regularity? You are going to say, my function f of x is not just one time differentiable. It's, let's say, s time differentiable. What does it mean? That means that now I can locally approximate my function with a Taylor series. So you approximate your locally your function with a polynomial, like this. And now the error is not going to decrease like x minus u to the power 1, but to the power s. Good, so now you have a much better approximation because your function is more regular. You are taking advantage of this regularity. So how many points do I need to cover my axis so that the error is going to be smaller than epsilon? Because here I have an exponent s, I can take points at a distance epsilon to the power 1 minus 1 over s. That means that I don't need to sample so close. I can sample my point more far away. Good, but what's happening in dimension D? In dimension D, the number of points will be m to the power minus d over s. D is the dimension, s is the regularity. The problem is d is 1 million, s is 2, 3, 4. Basically, s is small. So you will still have a curse of dimensionality. And that's the failure of approximation theory. All the functional spaces we are used to, like Holder space, Sobolev spaces, spaces of differentiable function, they are much too large. These notions of regularity are much too weak. You cannot learn such function without having a number of coefficients which explode. And that's not because of neural networks. Whatever technique will fail. So the problem of learning is to understand what kind of regularity can I impose on my function so that ultimately I will be able to learn it. Okay, so let's go to the algorithms. What do you do as a technique for learning? So the kernel learning techniques are relatively efficient, and I suppose you've all learned about them. The idea is you are going to do a change of variable. You take your function x, which, or your data x, which belongs to RD, and you are now going to transform it with a change of variable phi, and now you have a vector phi of x. So sometimes people think of it as a feature vector. I don't like this name because you can think of it as a feature vector in the sense that it corresponds to features of, for example, the images and so on. But what is behind is a very natural idea. When you have, for example, a set of differential equations which are very nonlinear, what is the first reflex that you have in math? You try to find a change of variable which is going to simplify your equation, which is, for example, going to linearize the equation. That's the same idea. You are trying to understand what change of variable is going to simplify the classification. And you try, in the same way then for PD, to linearize the problem. What does that mean? That means that hopefully the function f of x in this new space can be approximated by a simple linear function of your new variable. So a linear combination of the different phi k. Now, if you have a classification problem, then you have two classes, the blue and the red dots. That means that you are able to find a hyperplane which basically separates the two classes. That means that if you're on the left of the hyperplane, class 1, class minus 1. So in other words, this vector W corresponds to the vector orthogonal to the hyperplane. And if you project on W, you get, if you are positive, class 1, negative class minus 1. So everything is very simple. What is the difficulty? The difficulty is to find this miraculous change of variable which takes a horribly difficult problem and simplifies it in a simple linear problem. So, what did people thought in kernel learning around 1990s or early 2000? Basically, what you need is to increase dimensionality. And here, I'm sorry, I'm doing a caricature. But the problem was a little bit put below the rug through the following argument. If phi of x is a very high dimensional vector, then you have points in a very high dimensional space. And if the dimension of your space is bigger than the number of examples, then you can always find a hyperplane with very high probability that is going to separate the data. True. So that means that you've solved the problem with a simple increase of dimensionality. And that's what you should do. Phi of x of phi, that means that xi is transformed by phi. And that means that your vector now belongs to a space of very high dimension. And if you have points in a space of very high dimensions, if the dimension, as I said, is bigger than the number of points, unless you are very unlucky and all the points are in the same subspace, you will find a hyperplane which separates. Now, that doesn't really work because it creates what is called an overfitting problem. And the problem is the following. Yes, you can separate, but it's not going to generalize. And how you can see it? There is a very simple example of phi which is going to throw you in very infinite dimensional space is the phi such that the inner product between phi and phi of x prime is a Gaussian. A Gaussian exponential to x minus x prime divided by sigma. What is this doing? Essentially what it does, it takes a point and it makes a classification with all its neighbors within a distance sigma. But if sigma is small enough, you will have very few points in your neighborhood. And what you are basically doing here is a nearest neighbor classifier. And we know that in very high dimension, it doesn't work. It doesn't work because all the points are very far away, and your nearest neighbor has no reasons to be a point that belongs to your class. So that kind of strategy doesn't work in general. And what you rather want to try to do is to regularize your problem and reduce the dimensionality. So try to find a phi of x which will solve your problem in a lower dimensional space. And the question is it possible to do it? And that's where these deep networks comes in. So let me briefly begin by describing the architecture of these deep networks. I know that Joshua Bengio made a presentation, so I'm sure he already presented that in detail, but let me go again over it. I'm going to describe it in the case of an image, but I'll show many examples on audio signals and other type of signals. So suppose you have an image, which is your input x of u. You apply first a linear operator, but this operator is going to be a bunch of convolutions with small kernels like that, and each convolution is going to produce a different image, okay, with different filters. This will be my first layer. And the first layer is organized as a set of images that I will call along an axis that I call channels here. And I'm going to transform each of these images with my nonlinearity rule. Then, to build the next layer, I take each of these images to compute a coefficient here. I'm going to make a convolution with different filters small filters, and this is important, I'm going to sum the output and compute this coefficient. And I'm going to do that for each set of filters, and that's going to produce different set of images. And then I cascade until the last layer, from which I do a linear combination to get my result. Now, one important observation is that the last layer is much smaller than the original layer. So in some sense, if you view the last layer as being the result of your change of variable, you've been able to reduce the dimensionality before doing the final combinations to get your results. Okay, so what are the filters? You have filters here that are going to characterize each of these operators, and the nonlinearity, I'm just going to impose here that it is a contractive nonlinearity. What does that mean? It means that if I take two points u and u prime, rho of u prime should be smaller than u minus u prime. So you can take a rectifier, an absolute value, a sigmoid, all these things will work out. That's the organization. And Yann LeCun was, let's say, among the pioneers to propose that. So observe that this is a very structured machine, okay? And the remarkable thing is that you get state of the arts right now for almost all problems around as long as you have enough data. And you still need a lot of data because the number of variable which corresponds to the operator LJ here can be of the order of a billion variables. But it applies to speech, languages, biodata, and you've heard probably of the champion of the world of Go being beaten by such a machine. So the question is, why does it work so well? And it's a difficult problem. It's a difficult problem, and to emphasize that, I'll be showing the similarities with a problem in physics which is still totally open. Now, still, there is one element which is quite clear. If you think of depths, depth is a scale variable, or very close to a scale variable. So why is that so? If you take a point here, in the first layer, it was computed from a convolution with a very small filter. This filter can be 3x3 or 5x5, small, okay? So it's a very small aggregation of variable. If you pick a point in the next layer, here, it was obtained with a first filter, sorry, there is a downsampling, typically by a factor of 2, and a second filter. So if you do that, you have a cascade of 2 filters. The equivalent filter is going to be twice bigger because of the subsampling. So that means that you're aggregating more variables. If you go to even deeper, you are aggregating an even bigger set of variables. So as you go deeper and deeper and deeper in your network, you aggregate more and more variables with this scale factor. Okay. Now, the first problem, obviously, in this network is to learn the parameters. So the vector of parameter here is theta, is the set of all possible... Yes, sorry. Yeah, that would be good here. We can just close this down.
Thank you.
okay?
No, of course not.
I think it's an issue of the mic.
I don't think so.
No. So you have your parameter theta. You sure you don't want me to just get it out? Oh, because of the recording?
Recorded and broadcast elsewhere.
Okay, so you have your parameter theta, which is a set of variables that you want to optimize. And typically, as I said, you have potentially of the order of a billion variables. How do you optimize that? You basically use a very simple gradient descent algorithm. So what is the error? If you have an example xi, you're going to produce an output which is a function of xi and a function of the set of variables. And you want this output to be as close as possible to the true f of xi. So you have a loss function, for example, the squared. And you may regularize it by the L2 amplitude of your variables. So what is f of theta and x? It's just the series of non-linearity, linear operator, non-linearity, linear operators, and so on. What you would like is obviously to have a minimal average loss. So the basic algorithm consists in, as I said, just doing a gradient descent. You'll use what is called a stochastic gradient descent because you're going to loop over not the average error, but on each of the error for the xi. And for each of the xi, you compute the gradient at the current parameters you've calculated and xi, and you update your parameter following the well-known gradient descent update with a learning rate, which is just the gradient step. You iterate. Now, to do that, you need to compute the gradient. And the gradient, because it's a gradient relatively to all these variables which are factorized, you just use the chain rule, and you get the so-called backpropagation algorithm. Now, this shouldn't work. It shouldn't work in the sense that you know very well that you have a very non-convex problem. So if you begin from an initial point here, you should arrive to a local minima and not to the global minima. Now, arriving to a local minima is not a problem if the local minima has a height which is not so different from the global minima. And that's what seems to be observed numerically with these machines, in the sense that, yes, depending upon the initial point, you are going to learn different filters. But if you structure well your network, the results are all good, in the sense that the resulting error for the local minima that you are going to get is much better than any other techniques. Now, why is that so? This is still a completely open problem. It's an open problem. One argument is to say we are in very high dimension, so it's not likely that you are going to have a minima. That kind of argument is too superficial because it's very easy to build counterexamples where you're going to have local minima all over. Moreover, if you try to work with that kind of machine, you will realize that you need to use regularizers, so they are all kind of regularizers. And if you haven't spent already 1 year of your life working on that kind of thing, it's not going to work. It's going to be trapped in local minima all over. So there is a lot of know-how, a lot of cooking behind these things. But the fact is, it works remarkably well. So the first spectacular example was coming from ImageNet, which is a huge database with 1 million examples, 2,000 classes. This so-called AlexNet in 2012, which got remarkable results. One important observation, the first set of filters looks very much like wavelets. I'll be coming back to that. And currently, you have networks which go up to 150 layers with very small errors on that kind of database, very close to the type of errors human observers are doing. So very spectacular results. These are examples of images where you see complex images. It finds out that you both have a Dalmatian and you have cherries, beach wagon, convertibles, and so on. It's really spectacular.
What do you mean by an error?
An error means 5% errors. So it depends. In that kind of situation, that means that among the first five classes that it finds, you have the appropriate classes. And that's what I'm showing here are the first five classes. For example, it says that this image corresponds to a Dalmatian, to grapes, to Edelweiss, and so on. This is a convertible grid, and so on. And it happens that the label was grid for this image. And you compare that kind of performance to performance of humans, and you find out now that on this kind of database, you have of the order of same order of magnitude of errors. Exactly. Okay, I'm going to go closer to that question, but that's obviously one of the questions is what is these functional classes? I'll go back to that. Just one thing, these are industrial applications, huge. For example, the whole car industry, as you probably know, is being revolutionized because you have now cameras on cars that are working with that kind of deep networks and completely automated and remarkably reliable, despite one thing, finding the different obstacles where the road is and guiding the car. Now, still, you can have big errors. And these are examples of images, and that's true for almost all deep networks. You take an image, you add a very small error epsilon, which is shown here. This error epsilon was not chosen randomly. It was chosen by being optimized in order to trick the network. But still, it exists. This is the image, original image plus the error. Visually, it's identical. They are now all classified as ostriches. So there is a problem. The consequence of that is that you don't want to be in an airplane which is flew with a deep networks, because you never know. And that's one of the reasons, one, also you want to understand mathematically what's happening. There's two reasons. One is reliably. The second reason is that if you, as I said, haven't spent 1 or 2 years of your life optimizing a deep network, it's not going to work. So it's a pure experimental field, beautiful in terms of result, but we don't really understand. Another very spectacular thing. These networks seem to linearize what's happening. Let me explain that. You can try to invert these networks, beginning from the output, and essentially trying to compute invert filters to reconstruct an image. Now, people have been doing that, training the network on the specialized classes of images, for example, here, faces. You take a small vector corresponding to a man with glass. You take another vector corresponding to a man with no glass, and a third vector corresponding to a woman. Now, you take the man with glass, you subtract the vector of the other man, and you add the vector of a woman, you get a new vector, you reconstruct, you get a woman with glass. That means that you've been subtracting the manhood, and you've been adding glasses, and that's what you get, whereas if you would do the same thing on an original image, you get something which is garbage. That means as if you had linearized the notion of gender, you had linearized the action of putting a glass. Take, same thing, a database of bedrooms. Now, you reconstruct a bedroom from a first vector here, another bedroom from another vector here. Now, take the average of these two vectors, okay? You reconstruct from the small vector, which is the average of corresponding to this one and this one. And that's what you get. You get a new bedroom. That's very surprising. Because if you were taking these two images and taking the average, you would get garbage, okay? It's as if the set of bedrooms had been flattened up so that now you can take 2 points, you take the middle points, you still have a bedroom. As if you had linearized the so-called manifold, if such a manifold exists, of bedrooms. Why? Yes? No. None of these images are in the training data set. Okay, so at that point, there are many questions.
I have a question.
Okay, yes?
Yeah, Yeah. How does it compare with standard principal component analysis?
Sorry?
How does it compare with standard principal
component
analysis?
I'm going to speak about that in 1 minute. So, let me lay out some other questions, and I'll come back to this one. How come it reduced dimensionality without introducing errors? And how does it, for example, compare to principal component analysis? Why do you use convolutions in these structures? Why there is no other fitting? You have a billion parameters. One very important element of the sensors will be non-linearity or contractive. This network is contractive, contracting, contracting. Why hierarchical cascade, probably related to scale? So why do you use non-linearities, in fact? Why not making it all linear? It would be so much simpler. We see these linearization. What does it really linearize? Why is there such a linearization? You see all these channels. What is the roles of these channels? Why do they communicate? In what sense do they communicate? That's the kind of questions that I'll be asking, partly answering, partly not answering. Okay, so let's go back to the core idea. We want to reduce dimensionality to do learning. So we want to find a change of variable, phi of x, and obviously this change of variable has to be sufficient in order to do the recognition. So if you have 2 points, x and x prime, such as f of x is different than f of x prime, you don't want to confuse these 2 points. So their new representation have to be different, okay? That will guarantee that you can indeed write f of x as a function of this new variable. Okay, so linear principal component analysis. What's the idea? Suppose that you have the luck that all your classes, so what is a class? It's a set of points such as f of x is equal to a constant, 1, 2, 3, t, okay? Suppose that you're lucky enough that your classes are all parallel to a linear space. Then what can you do? What you can do is just project orthogonally to this linear space. Boom, you have a reduced dimensionality representation, and it's discriminative. And what will a PCA do? It will try to find what is the best linear space to do so. The problem is, that's the situation. You will never be lucky enough to have all your classes parallel to a very high dimensional linear space so that you can reduce dimensionality well by doing that. You may reduce 1, 2, 3 dimensions, but not a million dimensions. So if you're in this situation, and in fact you will be in this situation, one strategy is, let's try to linearize these level sets, because if you can indeed linearize these level sets, boom, then you can reduce dimensionality by doing the projection. So the whole problem will be, can you indeed linearize your level set to be able to do a dimensionality linearly that way? Now, the big difficulty is that you don't know the geometry to begin with. And you have to realize, this image that I showed where you have this jiggle line and you may think of jiggled surfaces is totally wrong in high dimension. It's totally wrong because in high dimension, the only thing you know is few points here and there. You don't have access to derivative, to manifold, to such things, just points spread around. So the whole problem is to understand how can you characterize the geometry of few points which are spread around in a space, which let's say belongs to two class, omega 1 and omega 2. What's the geometry of that set? Now, there is one classical tool to characterize a set of points which are spread like that, is to look at the symmetry of this set of points. So what does it mean, the symmetry of the set of points? The question you are going to ask is, what are the operators G such that if I apply G to any point, it will remain in the same class? So a red point will go to a red point, a blue point will go to a blue point. That means if you take X, you transform it with G, f of GX is equal to f of X. These are the symmetries of the system. The whole set of all possible such operators, it's called the symmetry group. So why is that a group? Because if G1 and G2 are symmetries, That means that f of g1, g2 of x is equal to f of x. But, sorry, if g1 and g2 are symmetries, if you compose both of them, because the first one is a symmetry is equal to f of g2 of x, second is a symmetry is equal to f of x. So the composition of two symmetry is a symmetry. So you can compose these things and you get a group structures. Why is that interesting? Because in math we know, how do you find a change of variable? To find a change of variable of a set of differential equation, you look at the symmetries of your set of equation and you find the change of variable which respect that symmetry. So you try to find the phi such that phi has the same symmetry as g, phi of gx will be equal to phi of x. And by doing so, you find a symmetry. So let me just briefly remind you, what is a group? A group is a set of operators, okay, such that if you compose any two elements of the group, it still belongs to the group. The inverse also belongs to the group. And if you make an associativity property, it's true. If it's commutative, then g, g prime is equal to g prime g, okay? So, the problem will be the following. You now have examples. Can you find the symmetry group of your examples? And how are you going to adapt phi? These are very difficult problems. And it looks like deep networks are able to solve such problems. So, let me go down to earth. What is examples of groups? Take an example of image processing. You want to recognize a digit, 3. If the 3 moves, or if you want to recognize an object, if I translate the object, it's the same object. I'm not changing the class by translating the image. So that means that the problem is invariant to translation, invariant to the translation group. Problem is, the translation group is very small. The position in 2D is characterized by 2 variables. So if you kill translation, you just kill 2 variables. You go from one dimension 1 million to 1 million minus 2. Big deal. So you want to find groups which are much bigger. Now, still take this example. Suppose now that you deform your signal, okay? Small deformation, it's still a 3. Small deformation, it's going to be a 5. If the deformation is too big, you can go from 3 to 5, then you change your class. Suddenly you have a new group, which is much, much bigger, which is the group of all possible deformation, the diffeomorphism group. And if you ride on your diffeomorphism group, you can like that travel across the whole Italian painting. You can see that as long as the deformation is small, you remain, let's say, essentially it's a very similar image. When the deformation is too big, then you change your class. Now, what we'll want to try to do is to find what are the appropriate invariants in such a big groups. And typically, the smaller deformation will provide the appropriate invariant. Let me go into another example. Audio. Top image. Bottom. That's a spectrogram. If you want to do speech recognition, you don't care about the voice, so you want to be invariant from the change of locutor. That means that this spectrogram and this spectrogram are essentially the same, belongs to the same class. Now, if you look what's happening when you go from one spectrogram to the other, you see that there is not just a translation in space, but also a transposition in frequency. You go from a woman to a man, so the frequency goes down. But it's not just a translation. You see that there is also a deformation. So the deformation is not just along time, but also along frequencies. So you have a new group appearing along the frequency translation. Two dimension, simple groups, rotations. When you rotate the image, you may decide it's the same or not. If you think, for example, of scaling, the same image may be viewed at different distance, corresponds to the same material, you may want to be invariant to dilation. You have many of these groups, but you can get much more complicated groups, and I'll come back to that at the end. Okay. Now, the problem is the following. If you take your point X and you move it through your group, normally it shouldn't change the class. So all the points which are moved from all the points of the symmetric group, all this corresponds to the same class. What do you want to do? As I said, you would like to transform that into a very regular surface so that you can take a simple linear projection and kill this variability. So the central issue will be, can you find your change of variable, phi of x, so that in this space, this is going to be very regular. You can at least impose that this is Lipschitz. So phi of x minus phi of x transformed by g has to have a distance which is of the order of the distance g. That's the minimum regularity that I will impose. What I'm going to show is that just by imposing that, we are going to arrive to deep networks. This is enough to arrive to deep networks if you think of translation deformations. Okay, what are the constraints? I want to be invariant to translation, so if G is just a translation of the spatial variable, the representation shouldn't change. And I want that if I have a much bigger group like deformations, so what is a deformation? It takes your image and it translates the image, but the translation depends upon the position. How much will the image be deformed? If tau of u is a constant, it's just a translation. If tau of u changes with u, then you have a deformation. The amount of deformation depends upon the derivative of tau. So it's the maximum of the gradient. That very standard measures of a diffeomorphism. So what you want is that the deformation of x transform should have a distance relatively to x transform, which is of the order of the deformation. Okay. What is the first reaction if you have such a problem? If you're doing physics, math, the first idea you have is to use the Fourier transform. Why? If you take a signal, you compute its Fourier transform. Now, if you translate your signal, you're just going to have a change of phase. If you take the modulus of the Fourier transform, it is therefore invariant by translation. So you have a translation invariant representation. Why nobody use Fourier transform for doing classification of images? If you take your image, you deform it. I do it here in 1D, an audio signal. That's the Fourier transform. If you deform it, the low frequencies are not going to move a lot, but the high frequency will move by a very big amount. If you look at the distance in the Fourier domain is going to be very big, even though the deformation was small. So Fourier is unstable to deformation. And that's where we are going to arrive to wavelengths. So what I'm going first to show you is a simplified neural networks to begin to understand how you arrive to this structure. How am I going to simplify the network? I'm not going to have the different images of a given layer, so the different channels, they are not going to communicate. That means that I'm going to make a tree. I'm going to have the same structure, filtering nonlinearity, but with a tree structure. We'll see that the math is simpler. And the other thing is I'm not going to learn. I'm going to say if I know the group, then I can predict what should be the filters. We'll see how far we can go with that, and we'll see how wavelet filters appear. What will be interesting is the limitation of these things. Why we cannot go so far? Yes?
Yeah, convolution is kind of low-pass filter.
Sorry?
Convolution is a kind of low-pass filter.
Yes.
So your deformations and your
high frequency. Yes, we'll have low-pass filters as well, absolutely. Okay. Now, why wavelets? Since we are here in a conference also about neurophysiology, we know that wavelets are there. We know that wavelets are in the cochlea. If you take the cochlea in the ear, we know that this is composed of a set of bandpass filters, and these bandpass filters are dilated. They have a constant Q for the one doing signal processing, and these are called wavelets. So, one question one may ask is, why do you have wavelets in the ear? And we'll also see in the visual system. So let me briefly summarize what a wavelet is. A wavelet is a sine wave, but localized. So it dies very quickly. So it's like a local sine wave. And on your local sine wave, you just do a dilation. So you dilate it, and the number of dilation per octave is your factor Q. And for audio, typically, we'll have something like 20 or 30 filters per octave. You take your signal, you filter it with your wavelet, so it's a convolution, okay? And obviously, in the Fourier domain, the Fourier transform is just going to be the product. So you look at the transfer function of your filter, of your wavelet, and you get bandpass filters like that, okay? Plus the low frequency that you can carry with a low-pass filter. So what is a wavelet transform? It's very simple. It's just a filter bank, a set of filters which are dilated. That's all my wavelets. And you can keep the average of the signal. For audio, the average will be zero. For other applications, we'll see the average will be useful. Okay? And these are the high frequency of the signal. And you can show that if all the filters cover very well the frequency axis, with the Planchrel formula, you can verify that the whole energy of the signal is the sum of the energy of all these wavelet coefficients. Okay. I'm going immediately to jump to images to show that this is exactly the same math. So in images, we know that there are things which look like wavelets which are in the V1 visual cortex since Ubel and Wiesel experiments. So you have these hypercolumn structures. I'll go very fast on that because you are the specialists are not. But you have these hypercolumn structures. They realize that you have filters or neurons that in a first approximation behave like linear filters. What many people did in the 80s and 90s is to compute the impulse response of these filters. And they realized that the impulse response of these filters looked like Gabor function, like Gaussian modulated by a sine wave and a cosine. When you move around in the visual cortex, around this hypercolumn structure, the orientation of your Gabor wavelet changes. When you go towards the centers of your hypercolumn, you have the scale which changes. Okay. And then you have these so-called complex cells. And what people observed in the 80s, 90s is that they are getting more and more invariant to translation, potentially sometimes rotation or scaling, but mostly translation in V2. And when you move towards even higher cortical regions such as V4, there is even the notion of complex cells or grandmother cells or grandmother networks, where you have cells or networks of cells which are invariant to very complex structures. They will respond, for example, if it's a truck, whatever the direction, the color of the truck, and so on. So you observe these layers of environment which are getting more and more powerful as you go in your networks. Okay, so what is these visual wavelets? In 2D, a wavelet, it's like in 1D. It's a function which is a local sine wave. So here it's a complex function. This is the cosine Gabor wavelet. Your Gaussian modulated by a cosine and by a sine. I'm going to rotate my wavelet like I showed for Ubel and Wiesel models. Okay, so that's the wavelet rotated. And I'm going to scale the wavelet. So it's like in one dimension, okay? It's a function which is scaled. Like in one dimension, I just do a convolution. So I take my wavelet, my signal, sorry, and I filter it with a wavelet. So I can look at its transfer function, the Fourier transform of the wavelet. What is it? It's a Gaussian modulated, so it has been deported in the Fourier domain somewhere here. If you rotate, the Fourier support is going to rotate. If you scale your wavelet, that was the rotation, and I'm going to scale it. In the Fourier domain, you scale it. So you cover the whole Fourier domain with all your wavelet filters. Therefore, if you now take your signal and you filter it within each of these frequency channels, you are going to be able to recover your signal. I'm also going to keep the average, which is the averaging, which is at the center here. And like in 1D, I can have conservation of energy. So mathematically, 1D, 2D, it's the same object. You have a filter which is dilated. You filter with this, you produce response in different channels, and they are enough to reconstruct the signal. Okay, so why wavelets? There are several arguments. The first one, you want to be stable to deformation. And to be stable to deformation, you want to have a function such that if you deform it a little bit, it looks like itself. That requires to have a function which is well localized in space. That will be respected by a wavelet transform. If you take a wavelet, you deform it, the distance remains of the order of the deformation. We know that we want to separate scale information because we know that's a way to reduce complexity of function. That's exactly what wavelets are done. And there is this notion of sparsity. We'll see that it compresses the signal. Okay, let me first show a simple example. Suppose you have a function which is piecewise regular with singularities like that, okay? What do you do? You take your signal, you take your wavelet, and you move around the wavelet on the whole support of the signal. And each time you compute the correlation. That's what a convolution is. That's the response. The response, if the signal is very regular, the wavelet is oscillating, the response will be nearly zero. The local contrast of the function is negligible. Big response whenever you have discontinuities, okay, or singularities. Same thing for audio. Now I have an audio signal. This is time. I'm going to do the filtering with all the wavelets. That's the frequency, center frequency of the wavelet. And what I get is a spectrogram, okay? And you see the harmonic structure of your audio signal. Okay, now what do I want to do? I want to have something which is invariant in translation. Suppose you have a function like this. Suppose you want to make it invariant to translation, and you want to be linear. The only way to build something which is invariant to translation and linear is to average. So let's average the function. If you average it with a low-pass filter on a small scale, you're going to get a nice, more regular function like that. And this is almost invariant to translation as long as you translate by a distance which is smaller than your averaging scale. If you want something which is completely invariant to translation, what do you need to do? You need to completely average. Okay, good. That's what you get. And what's the problem? You've lost everything. And that's the problem of invariant. You are always afraid of losing too much information. So that's the only invariant you can get if you are linear. Where did you lose information? Well, the information you lost are all the high frequencies. Let me recover these high frequencies by doing filtering with wavelets. How does it look like, the wavelet coefficient of this function? It's going to be an oscillating function. I have a complex wavelet. So here I have the real part and the imaginary part. Okay? If you average that, you're going to get zero. There is no way you can get more information with a linear operator. But what can you do? Like Fourier. You can kill the phase. If you kill the phase, you get the envelope, okay? So that's the nonlinearity, the modulus. Okay, this is still not invariant to translation. If X translates, the envelope is going to translate, contrarily to the Fourier transform, because the wavelet is local. So you need to make this invariant to translation. How can you do it? You can average. Good. Let's average that. Now you have something which is much more regular, or it may be completely invariant to translation. But if you do that, you've lost information. What information did you lose? Well, you lost the high frequencies of this envelope, okay? How can you recover the high frequency of the envelope? You can take the envelope and you filter it with wavelets. So you can take the envelope and you can compute its wavelet coefficient. But these coefficients, now you want to make an invariant out of it. How? You can apply a nonlinearity, modulus, and then average. And what did I do? A deep network. Let me show that. Oh, not yet. Here, The first layer of the wavelet coefficient, before going to the deep network interpretation, what do I do? On this thing, and I apply a second set of wavelets. And what are these second set of wavelets tell you? They will tell you information about the geometry of the signal. So these new invariants don't tell you just where the singularity, but how are the singularity organized. Before showing you the deep networks, I'm going to show you examples on audio. So that's the first example of audio signal. This is a sharp attack, tremolo, and a vibrato. This is a spectrogram. You can think of that as the wavelet coefficients. Now, if you average these wavelet coefficients, this is what you're going to get. You see, you are averaging in time these images, and if you do that, the tremolo disappear, the vibrato disappear. All these things look alike. What will these second layer coefficients give you? They will give you the variation along time of this curve before the averaging. So for that, you're going to convolve with a new set of wavelets. You're going to get for each lambda one here, a new variable lambda two, and it will give you a spectrogram of this curve as you move. And you see here, very small low frequency, it was a very slow attack. This was a very sharp attack. You see here the tremolo and the vibrato. So it's the second layer of invariants that will capture the type of sounds that you have. This is another visualization of what we are doing. These are the set of coefficients here. Now you average your spectrogram in time. These are the invariants. Now, you are getting the information that you've lost, which is the variation along each of the curve. You have a new spectrogram for each of these. And now you have a representation with three variables. You average in time. That's the invariant you get. And that's how you build up invariants. And a little bit later, sorry, I'm going to show you. That's exactly a deep network which is being done. Let me, to do the relation with deep network, explain in what sense this is obtained with a cascade of filters. In the 80s, there was a lot of work in signal processing on something called filter banks. And it's only afterwards that people realized that these filter banks were related to wavelengths. And what I'm going to show is that these filter banks are inside these deep networks. So what is the simplest filter bank? Suppose you want to take a signal and you want to average the coefficients. How can you average the coefficient? You can do that with a pyramidal algorithm. First, you average each of the coefficients by pair, like here, this pair, and so on. So you get the average, the second, the third average, and so on. That's the averages. Then you take each of the coefficients by pair and you again compute the averages. And then you compute again the average, and you get your final average. Okay, so that's a factorization of the average in terms of cascade of small averaging by pairs. If you do this, you did on one hand an averaging, you lost information. You did the average of two numbers. What's the information you lost? The difference between the two numbers. That's my high pass filter. Okay? Now, these things can be viewed as convolution. This is a low-pass filter. This is a high-pass filter with a very elementary filter, addition, subtraction. Suppose now you cascade that. You do a first averaging and a high-pass filter. Now, this averaging, I want again to do the averaging, I said, and now I get the difference. That's it. This cascade is a wavelet transform. What does it do? It takes the input through the cascade of averaging. It makes a global averaging. That's your low-pass filter. That's what is going to build something which is invariant to translation. And here, what are you doing? You're averaging and then taking a difference. You are making a convolution with a filter which looks like this. This is a simple oscillating function. It's a particular wavelet. It's a Haar wavelet. Take take the same thing for an image. Suppose you want to do your Gabor transform. First, you are going to apply a set of filters like this to get the high frequencies along different orientations, and you are going to average. That's the very fine scale information. Then you take the low frequencies and you reapply a set of filters. Okay, you are going to get the next scale information and the average. And then you reapply a set of filters. That's your filter G that will give you your wavelength, and so on. What you get is a filter bank, which extracts the high frequency, low frequency, the high frequency, low frequency. This is a wavelet transform. That's how you compute a wavelet transform. You compute it with a bunch of filtering like that. And you see that that begins to look a little bit like a deep network. You have a filter and you have a nonlinearity, which is the absolute value. The difference is that the deep network has an output which is at the bottom. But that's the first transform. What did we say? We said that we wanted to build an invariant from this wavelet coefficient. To build an invariant from this wavelet coefficient, we need to average it. So we need to average, 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 we get that. But if we do that, we said we're going to lose information. How are we going to get the information that we lost? By computing the wavelet transform of this. So that's what we get. That's what we did here. But these numbers here, we want to build them down because we want them to be invariant to translation. How are we going to do it? We're going to reapply a wavelet transform for each of them. See? You reapply a wavelet transform, you reapply until everything is at the bottom. And that's a deep network. That's a deep network. It's just a cascade of filters, absolute value. Could be any nonlinearity, such as a rectifier. Filter, absolute value. Filter, absolute value, and so on. The only difference with a deep network is that no connections across channels, and I impose the filter. What I'm going to show, the second part, is that with this, you can already begin to understand what's happening in the properties of these networks. We will be able to understand the relation with groups, but we will also understand why you need to learn. Because the problem is that if you know a priori the group, I can give you the filters, but if you want to go beyond the simple groups, you need to learn the filters. In this case, just I will finish on that. What is the output of the network? Yes?
An algebra of something, those are operations, capital W1 on X and then capital W2.
Okay.
Or is that representing these operations that you talked about?
It's representing the operations. So what I mean by that is that what is the first wavelet transform W1 computing? So it's obtained with a cascade of filters, but if you look at the equivalent filter, you see if you are here, the equivalent filter is a convolution with a wavelet, okay, with a modulus. So that's all these wavelet coefficients were computed by this first operator, and it's computing this. Now, if you are here, you apply the second set of wavelet filters. It's making a convolution with a second set of wavelets. And you may apply a third set of wavelets and so on. So you have a cascade of convolution, nonlinearity, and at the end, everything is average. So at the end, everything is invariant to translation, if J is big enough. All these coefficients are many, many, many nonlinear invariants, which are obtained. And that's the difference with the standard mathematics we were used to do in the 1990s and up to 2000. What everybody was doing was things like wavelet transform. We were separating scales. But what these things do, and which we know is very important in physics, it also trying to understand how the different elements at different scales are related by putting yet a new wavelet and a third wavelet and so on. So we're looking at interactions of scales. So we're going to see, because this structure is relatively simple, what's the property of the output? The output is the set of all these coefficients that I call here scattering coefficient, because they are scattered like that in a network with wavelets. And we'll see that that helps to understand a little bit what's happening in these networks. But I'm going to stop here because